Penguin Random House Audio presents The Other Mrs. Miller by Allison Dickson. Read for you by Holly Palance. For Ken, who has seen and loved every version of me. Part 1. Mrs. Miller. Chapter 1. The blue car is there again this morning. It's parked just down the block, never in the same spot twice, but always within easy view of Phoebe's peering eyes. The older Ford Focus, with its rusted fenders and a cracked windshield that makes seeing the driver almost impossible, even with powerful binoculars, would go unnoticed almost anywhere else in Chicago. But on a quiet Lake Forest street, where a three-year-old Land Rover seems ancient, it sticks out like a rotting incisor in a set of bleached teeth. The only clue to the driver's identity is a magnet on the front passenger door that reads, Executive Courier Services, but she has yet to see any delivery take place. Phoebe isn't exactly sure when the car first started showing up, but once she noticed its repeat visits, she began keeping a log, like the sort of busybody neighborhood watch captain who would ordinarily annoy her. In the little notebook are three columns: when the car arrives, where it parks, when it leaves. The appearances seemed more sporadic at first, maybe two or three times a week, for an hour at most. But for the last week, the car has been there daily and staying for at least 3 hours, sometimes as many as five, well beyond any normal break in a workday. If the occupant has exited to so much as stretch their legs, Phoebe hasn't noticed. She has considered asking the neighbors what they think about this interloper, but in the years she's lived in this house, she hasn't gone out of her way to make friends with any of them. It's not that she doesn't like people. She just, well, maybe that isn't too far from the truth. People are burdensome beasts, always prepared to lump their expectations onto you. This is especially true if your name lends you a little status, however dubious that status may now be. She's tried expressing these concerns to her husband, but Wyatt thinks she's being paranoid about both the recurring car and what the neighbors probably think of her. He insists it's just stress, that the media frenzy will pass when someone else either dies or says something stupid approximately 3 seconds from now. Because he's a therapist, his smugness when he says these things is thick enough to gag her. The subtext, of course, is that she has far too little to do with her day if parked cars and imagined gossip are the sorts of things that occupy her mind. He may be right, but it still makes her grit her teeth. Calling the police is an option she's mulled over a few times, but what exactly would she say? This isn't a gated community. People can come and go as they please. A lifetime ago, a less reclusive Phoebe wasn't interested in a walled-off fortress like so many of the other places here, or especially like her father's oppressive lakefront estate in Glencoe. She was taken by this house's relative normalcy. How openly the modest by comparison Tudor-style home at the end of the lush cul-de-sac presented itself to the world, with only a couple of neighboring houses in decent but not overly intimate proximity. That accessibility is biting her in the ass now with this car in the picture. But then again, she's received no threats or strange phone calls. All she has is exhaustion-fueled speculation, and not even a description of the driver, who she's about 90% positive is either a woman or a very slight man, based mostly on the petite silhouette. The only other details she can note with any confidence are the light blue shirt and baseball cap, an apparent uniform, because she's probably just a flipping delivery driver, she thinks in her husband's calmly exasperated voice. So no, she won't call the cops. Not until she has a real reason. Of course, Phoebe could put all these questions to rest right now. Just step outside, walk up to the car, knock on the window, and kindly ask what they want. But with everything else going on, she can't handle the thought of being even a little humiliated. What if this really is just some lowly courier who likes to sit there for breaks and catch up on paperwork? Or a friend of one of the neighbors Phoebe has spent years ignoring? She can already hear them gossiping. Oh, her? That's Phoebe Miller. Haven't you heard of her? Well, surely you know about her father. Then there's the worst case scenario, that this courier could actually be a reporter scoping her out, waiting to catch some unflattering footage of a disheveled heiress at the height of her paranoid desperation. The public would cease to function without its regular dose of schadenfreude after all. Why shouldn't she have her time in the limelight? But she's also begun to consider a likelier reason for her inaction. Watching this car has become a game for her, a blip in her otherwise flat line of a day. The truth of this person is probably so mundane, it would only add to her depression if she learned it. So why bother? Let her enjoy this one odd thing. It won't last forever. Nothing does. After making note of today's appearance, she returns to the kitchen to refill her coffee and focus on other things, like what Wyatt wants for dinner tonight, and whether he's going to watch the remaining episodes of Game of Thrones with her, or if she should go ahead and knock them out herself. Ah, the glamorous life. He's currently slurping down a bowl of cereal, and the sound immediately grates on her nerves. Has he always done that? Or is she just now starting to notice it after 10 years? She's discovered several other micro-habits of his lately that make her fantasize about bludgeoning him with an iron skillet like an old-fashioned cartoon wife. For instance, when he pretends he's about to laugh right after he says something passive-aggressive, which seems to be every other sentence that leaves his mouth these days, or the way he licks his finger every time he turns a page in a magazine. Phoebe is certain she can now hear the rubbing of his tongue against the ridges of his fingertips, and she has to leave the room as soon as she sees him going for his Newsweek or Rolling Stone. In a more cliché man move, he has also started leaving his hair in their bathroom sink after he cleans out his electric razor. But of all the ways her husband has found to grind her gears, she's sure it's the disgusting racket of his slurping, crunching, and tearing into his every meal that will finally send her over the edge. She recently read about a study linking a sensitivity to eating sounds to a higher IQ. Phoebe is sure she now qualifies for a Mensa membership. She soothes herself with a simple thought. In just a few minutes, he will be off to work. Blessed silence will soon wrap around her like a fuzzy blanket, at which point she'll lock all the doors, arm the security system, and return to bed, spreading her arms and legs wide across both sides like a starfish. Sometime around noon, she will get up, put on her bathing suit, and bring a book and a bottle of wine poolside. 2 hours before Wyatt comes home from work, she will put on actual clothes and brush her hair, trying to ignore the outgrown roots and the split ends that have cropped up over the months since she last visited a salon. She'll dab on a little makeup, hoping to hide the deepening lines around her eyes and brighten her increasingly sallow complexion. She will put on clothes that have a bit of extra stretch in them to accommodate her ever-widening rear end. She can't recall suddenly letting herself go. It feels like more of a gradual surrender. Even 2 years ago, she wouldn't have thought twice about spending hours in the salon or covering herself in dozens of expensive serums and creams designed to make women think they can roll back the miles on the odometer. She vividly recalls spending 2 or 3 hours a day in the gym while partaking in whatever fad diet promised to keep the dreaded muffin top at bay if she avoided this one newly reviled ingredient. That pampered cream puff version of herself hadn't yet succumbed to several failed fertility treatments. She also hadn't watched the father she'd spent most of her life fearing, hating, and loving in painfully equal measure, die so rapidly of pancreatic cancer that he'd had no time to leave her with any of the closure or apologies he'd surely spent his whole life hoping to gift her. Now, in the aftermath of Daniel's death, she more closely resembles an actual cream puff.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.